Well, first of all, I want to welcome everyone to the latest of the UCAR Presidential Series briefings. My name is Scott Rader, and I'm with UCAR. And first of all, I want to apologize. We were originally going to meet up in one of the science subcommittee rooms, but came down here. It's a little bit small. We apologize. And what I promise is that we will try and get through things as fast as possible so we can get to questions, because I think you'll have a lot of questions after you hear some of the information. And with that, let's just get moving forward. I want to introduce my boss, Dr. Michael Thompson of the University Corporation for Atmospheric Research.
Thank you, Scott, and good afternoon, everyone. My name is Michael Thompson, as Scott said, and I am the interim president of the University Corporation for Atmospheric Research, or UCAR. So welcome to our briefing today on the state of the Arctic, forecasting environmental change, risk, and opportunity. Before we get started, I want to say particular thanks to House Science Committee Chairman Lamar Smith and his staff, as well as the Chairman of the House Oversight and Government Reform Committee, Jason Chaffetz, and also to Willie Marks for making this room available to us today. So for those of you unfamiliar with UCAR, UCAR is a non-profit consortium of 105 member universities that grant advanced degrees in the atmospheric sciences. UCAR also manages the National Center for Atmospheric Research on behalf of the National Science Foundation. The research conducted by the UCAR community helps to inform decision makers. It also provides benefits back to society by improving our predictive and forecasting capabilities in the areas of weather, water, climate, and space weather. Several times a year, we bring members from our research community to the Hill to discuss the latest science in areas of importance to policymakers, which brings me to our briefing topic today, the Arctic. The retreat and eventual loss of summertime Arctic sea ice is perhaps the biggest environmental challenge of our lifetimes. Sea ice has retreated rapidly in the last 10 years. The Arctic has warmed about four times faster than the global mean since the modern satellite era began in 1979. Scientists are working to improve seasonal forecasts of Arctic sea ice extent. This is a challenging problem. Researchers need more observations, especially of sea ice thickness and clouds from satellites, to improve our understanding of Arctic climate and sea ice loss. The loss of sea ice is also creating new opportunities for mineral exploration, tourism, fishing, and development. Today, you're going to hear from three leading Arctic researchers. From your right to your left, except the other way around for those sitting behind, closest to me, Dr. Jennifer Kay is an assistant professor in the Department of Atmospheric and Oceanic Sciences at the University of Colorado, Boulder, and a visiting scientist at the National Center for Atmospheric Research. Dr. Kay is an expert on the complex processes that affect Arctic climate and will be providing us with an overview about why sea ice is disappearing. Dr. JULIENNE STROEVE is a scientist with the U.S. National Snow and Ice Data Center at the University of Colorado and professor of polar observations at University College London. Dr. STROEVE conducts field studies in the Arctic and uses satellite observations and advanced computer models to better understand Arctic climate. Her talk today will focus on making seasonal predictions of sea ice. Finally, Dr. David TITLEY is director of the Center for Solutions to Weather and Climate Risk at Pennsylvania State University and US Navy Rear Admiral retired. His focus is on helping organizations and citizens succeed in our current climate, as well as prepare for the climate of the future. Dr. TITLEY is an expert on climate, the Arctic, and national security. He will focus his presentation on how the changing Arctic will present challenges for national security. So we're going to have the three presentations, and I would ask, if you will, that you would keep questions until we have heard from all three speakers, and we'll take them at the end. And as Scott said, we will leave plenty of time for questions. Of course, if there are any short questions that you urgently need to ask by way of clarification, then by all means, ask those as we go along. And so without further ado, Dr. Jennifer Kay.
So thank you, Michael. So I'm Jennifer Kay. I'm a professor in Boulder at the Department of Atmospheric and Oceanic Sciences. And before beginning, I just want to really thank you guys for funding the research that we do. In particular, my funding comes from NASA and from the National Science Foundation, which supports NCAR, which is where I sort of made my go in a career looking at science. So I'm going to give sort of a long-term perspective about Arctic sea ice loss and warming, and I want to clarify what I mean by a long-term perspective. So I'm going to talk about changes that have happened over my lifetime. So that may not be long to some scientists. It may be very long for those some of you in the room, but I just wanted to clarify that's the time scale that I'm going to talk about. So just going to start with an image produced by the National Snow and Ice Data Center showing where there is sea ice coverage in the Arctic, basically right now. And so if you look, you know, you see Alaska and Russia for reference, and the colors that are white and light blue, that's where there's ice, so close to the North Pole. But you see there's whole regions of the Arctic along the coastline where there is no ice. And this actually represents a rather dramatic change in the Arctic climate system, as we heard briefly from Michael Thompson. So I just want to clarify that, you know, it still gets cold in the Arctic in the winter. There's no sun shining there. So in March, as this image on the left shows, there's a lot more ice than there is in September on the right. And you can see we have these 2 years, 2015 and 2012, where I'm showing the amount of ice in the Arctic in March and September. So why did I pick these years? Well, these years are both record-breaking years. So we're losing Arctic sea ice in all months of the year. But that change is particularly dramatic if you look in the late summer and September. So like right now, there's not as much ice as there was previously. And September 2012 is sort of the record-breaking year. Next slide. So here's just a time series showing from satellite observations the extent of Arctic sea ice coverage. So bringing it to this time scale, I was born in the late 1970s. That was a pretty exciting time. So we had the first satellites. So the satellites started to measure where the sea ice was, and the first like routine, you know, regular measurements of sea ice showed, you know, 7 to 8 million square kilometers. So at that time, that was when I was born. In 1999, I graduated from college. I actually spent a year in DC. I worked near Metro Center for an economic consulting firm. And at that point in time, the ice had started to go down a little bit. I decided I wanted to go back to school and get a PhD in science, so that's when I did. And then if you look in the most recent years, when I've become a professor at the University of Colorado, you can see, for example, 2012, the Arctic sea ice was at about 3.5 million square kilometers. So that is half of what it was when I was born. This is a huge change, and it's not one that we can explain by natural variability alone. So what else was going on in the late 1970s, aside from the first routine satellite measurements of sea ice? Well, the first climate models were being run, and those studies, building on earlier studies, predicted Arctic sea ice loss and greater than global Arctic warming. So on the left here, we have a picture of a supercomputer from those days. So a supercomputer is in quotations because the supercomputers at that time had about a half a megabyte of memory. So if you know anything about your phones and digital cameras, and you know this thing really had nothing compared to the type of computing power that we have now. So that's another change that's really happened over my lifetime that's really fundamentally changed things. But some things, actually, even with this very, you know, basic computer, were really obvious. So a paper written by Manabi and Stouffer, Dr. Manabi featured at the bottom of the slide, written in 1980 when I was three, The CO2-induced warming of the surface air temperature is particularly large in high latitudes. And this paper by Manabi and Stouffer, where they did experiments where they increased the greenhouse gases, showed the Arctic being in particular a place where a lot of ice was lost and there was greater than global warming. So you might ask, you know, what has really happened since Manabi and Stouffer in 1980? And we've shown you some of the dramatic changes in the sea ice, but what about air temperatures? So also, things that Manabi and Stouffer reported, warming globally and especially in the Arctic in response to a CO2 quadrupling in their study. And this is what we see. 1979 to present, the Arctic has warmed 4 times more than the global mean. This is based on the best observations that we have, and believe me, these records have been scouted over by tons of people. This is really not something that we can get around. The globe is warming, and especially in the Arctic. So you might ask if these early scientists, you know, why they were able to predict this change. Why is the Arctic warming 4 times more than the global mean? And the answer to that is that the Arctic has positive feedbacks. And so by this, I don't mean, you know, high fives. What I mean is self-reinforcing cycles, things that, you know, you start to warm one thing and it keeps warming. So a classic example of this is something called the surface albedo feedback. And let me just walk you through it because it's one of the basic reasons that the Arctic warms more. So when you have less sea ice, you have a darker ocean surface. And just like when you wear, you know, a black t-shirt on a hot summer day, that dark ocean surface absorbs a lot of sunlight. And so when you have that sunlight absorbed, it actually tends to then melt more sea ice, right? So you can see how you're kind of building on each other, where the initial loss of ice leads to a darker surface, which leads to warming, which leads to more ice melting, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. It's a self-repeating cycle that goes in the direction of enhancing the initial warming. So you often hear about the Arctic and Arctic feedbacks, and people stop there. And the Arctic is really a lot more complex than a single feedback. If the sea ice albedo feedback was the only feedback operating in the Arctic, it would just continue to melt indefinitely. There's a whole number of feedbacks that are at play. Those feedbacks really determine how fast the Arctic system warms. In general, the Arctic has positive feedbacks, which is why it's warming, but it's definitely a more complex system than a single feedback, and that's why, you know, I have a job. Like, I enjoy studying that and trying to figure out why it's warming and how much. So I often get asked about sea ice predictions, and many of you are probably curious to know, when is the Arctic going to go ice-free? And if someone asked me if sea ice is going to go up or down over the next 30 years, so, you know, about the time frame over which I've talked about so far, my answer would be definitely with continued greenhouse gas emissions, sea ice is going to disappear, especially in late summer, but at all times of the year, it will continue to go away. So some take-home messages. The Arctic warming and sea ice loss were predicted decades ago. Sea ice is a very responsive variable. It really cares about the greenhouse gases in the atmosphere, and so it makes it a really good climate indicator. And so it's very responsive. Of course, we still have some unknowns, even though we know, you know, sea ice goes away when the climate warms. Some of those unknowns include the loss rate, which again depends on these feedbacks that are competing with each other. And then on short-term predictability, which is something of interest to a lot of stakeholders in the Arctic, this is actually what JULIENNE is going to focus on in her presentation. That's really an area where we're still learning a lot, and knowing what the initial state of the system is really important. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to JULIENNE STROEVE from the National Snow and Ice Data Center. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Jen, for that great overview. And as Jennifer mentioned, I'm going to focus a little bit more on seasonal ice forecasting. But before I do, I think it might be useful to put the changes that we're seeing in the modern satellite data record into a longer-term perspective. So the modern satellite data record began in October of 1978. But there are earlier satellite missions from the 1960s and 1970s. There's also aircraft observations or ship observations. There's earlier whaling logbooks from like 1850 to the early 1900s that allow us to be able to extend the ice record back in time. And so there's a new data set that NSIDC will be releasing pretty soon. This was done with NOAA funding by one of my colleagues at the National Snow and Ice Data Center, as well as some colleagues at a couple other institutes. And it allows us to go back to 1850. And so what I'm just showing in this plot is the sea ice extent, like what Jennifer was showing for September, but now going all the way back to 1850. And you can see there's this long-term decline in the ice cover. I mean, if we were to just approximate the ice loss from 1850 to present, it's declining at a rate of about 20,000 square kilometers per year, or a little bit less than the state of New Jersey every year. But if we go to the more recent period, we see that the ice loss is much faster. It's about 83,000 square kilometers per year, or about the size of South Carolina every year that we're losing right now. And even if you were to split the satellite data record in half and just look at the first half and the second half, the rate of ice loss right now is four times faster than it was in the earlier part of the satellite data record. So it's an accelerated rate of ice loss, and it really shows that something fundamentally different is happening right now in the Arctic today than it was happening, you know, several decades ago. Next slide. So as you would expect, I mean, as we're losing more and more of the ice, some of these shipping routes are becoming more accessible. The fabled Northwest Passage, which runs along the Canadian Arctic Archipelago, shown in red there, that opened for the first time in our satellite data record in 2007. And both the Parry Channel and the Edmonton's route along the coast of Canada were open in 2007. Now, on the other side of the Arctic, the Northern Sea Route, which goes along Russia, that wasn't open in 2007, but it's been open every year since 2008. And when we think about shipping in the Arctic, this is usually the route that a lot of people are focusing on because we think that will probably be a more viable shipping route in the future. And compared to the Suez Canal, the Northern Sea Route is about 3,000 kilometers shorter, takes about 10 days of less navigation time than the Suez Canal. But even though there's optimism about using the route, I mean, obviously the number of transits going through the Northern Sea Route right now is still quite small. In 2011, for example, there were 33 transits made compared to 18,000 using the Suez Canal. But certainly Russia has high hopes that this route will be developed more, and they've been changing some of their regulations. They have been increasing the number of permits in recent years. So in 2010, for example, they had issued 4 permits to use the Northern Sea Route, and in 2013, there was more than 200 issued. So there's definitely this increase in interest in developing the Northern Sea Route. Next slide. So one of the things that I've been doing a little bit in some of my studies, working with an economist in the UK, is just looking at, you know, what is our probability that the route will be ice-free in the future? And climate models really are our best tools to try to make these sort of assessments. So we can use climate model projections out in the future and look at the probability of there being any ice within the Northern Sea Route as we go out in the future. And so what I'm showing is results for two different cases. One, assuming that the Northern Sea Route has to be at least 80% probability that it's entirely ice-free. And the other, and that's on the left. And then on the right, showing a more relaxed criteria where there's a 50% chance that the route will be entirely ice-free during this, along the entire route. So you can see that, you know, when we look at the more strict requirements, I mean, you might end up with 3 months of navigation time by the end of the century if we keep warming the atmosphere with greenhouse gases. So basically assuming business as usual, we're not doing any mitigation in terms of greenhouse gases. This is sort of what it looks like right now in the future for the Northern Sea Route. If we are more relaxed about our requirements and assume that there's still going to be icebreakers operating, then there might be 5 months of total navigation time by the end of the century under these climate emission scenarios. Okay. So obviously, as the Arctic Ocean is becoming more ice-free in summers, there's a lot of increased economic interest in the Arctic in regards to shipping or resource extraction. Also, coastal communities are operating more in the Arctic as well, and so they need a better understanding of what the ice conditions are going to be every summer. And so we get requests even as early as January from different stakeholders asking us, you know, how much ice is going to be there this summer. And so in response to this, in 2008, the Arctic Research Consortium of the United States led this informal effort to get predictions of September sea ice extent from the international community. And so they just had this informal effort. They would disseminate results on their website. And then in 2013, this project was taken over by this multi-agency funded project that I'm leading up, which has money from NASA, NSF, NOAA, the DOE, as well as Office of Naval Research. And so we're trying to turn this informal effort into a more robust analysis of how well sea ice predictions are working on a seasonal timescale and seeing how we can make improvements. So I just thought I would show this plot. So this is just showing our forecast that we've been receiving since 2008 through 2015 of what the September sea ice extent is going to be every summer. So the blue line is the median of all the predictions that we receive. And we receive predictions based on people's best guesses, based on using statistical models or really sophisticated ice, ocean, atmospheric models. So any sort of predictions that people want to give us are included in this. The gray shading sort of shows the spread of all the predictions, and the red shows the observed amount of sea ice extent for that year. And so you can see this sort of as bimodal pattern of success. So some years the predictions seem to work quite well. So if we look at 2008 or 2010, 2011, and even this year, because it's within the gray shading, the forecasts that we're getting closely match what the observed sea ice extent was. But then there are other years where it falls really far off. So in 2009 and 12 and 2013 and 14, the predictions did not do so well. And what we're finding right now in terms of the sea ice cover in the Arctic is that, you know, when the sea ice extent falls really far from the accelerating long-term trend line, we don't do so well. And this has been unfortunate. When the ice sort of follows this accelerating rate of ice loss, the predictions seem to do okay. Next slide. One thing, too, though, I mean, this has been sort of an intellectual exercise for scientists to see how well we can forecast the overall September sea ice extent, but obviously it's not that useful for stakeholders operating in the Arctic. And so the last couple of years, we've been requesting the people that do submit to our sea ice outlooks to also provide a spatial map, so the probability that there will be ice in the Arctic in September. And so this just gives you an example from several different groups that have participated in this. So we have results from NCAR, NASA, NOAA, contribution from the University of Washington, which are all based on using sophisticated physical ice ocean atmospheric models. And the black line shows where the ice was in 2014, and the red shading sort of give you the probability of there being ice. And what's interesting, I mean, the general overall shape of what we thought the ice cover would look like is not too poorly represented by a lot of these contributions, although obviously in some instances they either underpredicted the amount of ice that was going to be there, like in the case of NCAR, or in the case of NOAA, they overpredicted how much ice there would be. And interestingly enough, on the bottom right-hand side, I'm showing a statistical forecast model led by a colleague at the National Snow and Ice Data Center. This is a statistical model that actually seems to do quite well and right now is beating out a lot of these coupled ice-ocean model predictions. Next slide. So, of course, the question is, how do we improve our ability to do seasonal ice forecasting? And we are limited to some extent just by the chaotic nature of the atmosphere. We can't predict yet how much, what the atmospheric circulation is going to be like every summer, and because we cannot forecast the atmospheric circulation patterns, we can't exactly know sometimes how much ice is going to be left because the sea ice is still very dependent on what's going to happen in the summer. If you have an unusually cold summer like we had in 2013, a lot of that ice stuck around after the 2012 record minimum. We didn't forecast that. But we do understand that in order to improve our forecast, we definitely need more data. There's a lot of data that we don't have, for example, like sea ice thickness information, which many studies have shown is very critical to trying to initialize our forecast models. If you don't know at the beginning of the melt season how much ice you have, how thick that ice is, what the sea surface temperatures are, it's really hard to forecast what it's going to do for the summer. The U.S. right now does not have a satellite that gives us Arctic-wide sea ice thickness measurements. We will with the launch of ICESat-2, which is slated to happen, I think, in December of 2017. And we do have the NASA IceBridge mission, which is giving us some aircraft flights over, mostly over the Beaufort and the Chukchi Sea areas in March. So it gives us some data, but we don't have maps of the total Arctic right now. The Europeans do with Cryosat-2, and this is just an image showing the thickness distribution of Cryosat-2, showing the thickest ice is located north of Greenland and the Canadian archipelago, with thinner ice over towards the Siberian side. So this data we know is critical to help improve our forecasts. We also need a better understanding of some of the important processes that influence how much ice is melted every summer. And Jennifer alluded to this ice albedo feedback, and there was a study that came out last year that was showing that just knowing how many melt ponds are on the ice in the early part of summer, so in May and June, might help us improve our ability to forecast how much ice is left over in September, because if you form your melt ponds earlier in the springtime, that lowers the albedo, so more of that sun's energy is absorbed in the melt ponds, can further melt the ice throughout the summer. Okay, next slide. So, I mean, we're trying to look at different ways forward. You can go to the next. So, part of the issue for us is certainly that polar prediction lags weather prediction by several decades. So we're doing a huge catching up game right now in the Arctic. And so there's a lot of research now going into this, but we're several decades behind, unfortunately. But there is this new effort that is being proposed, the Year of the Polar Prediction, by the World Meteorological Organization, which is slated to run from mid-2017 through mid-2019. And the purpose of this effort is to bring together the international community in a period of very intensive monitoring in the Arctic, collecting observations that we know we need to drive our forecast models, verify these models, and also do a lot of user engagement. So to make sure that our forecasts and the way that we present our results is useful to stakeholders that are operating in the Arctic. And this is a really good opportunity for the U.S. to contribute to improved polar prediction. But, I mean, overall, what I wanted to just end with is that we really do need a dedicated polar prediction effort. And without that, it's hard for us to do good forecasts of ocean and waves, weather predictions in the Arctic. But it also matters for those of us living here in the United States as well, because by improving our ability to predict what's going on in the Arctic and understanding processes in the Arctic, we can do a better job at weather forecasting down here as well. Okay? And with that, I'm going to turn it over to David TITLEY, who's going to focus more on some of the security issues with the Arctic becoming more ice-free.
I'm not going to save my slide about what the bottom line is for the end, because just in case you guys like lose this, we have something in the Navy called bottom line up front, or the bluff. So this is kind of it. And I hope you've already seen from Jennifer and Julian that the Arctic is changing. It's changing faster than any other place in the world. And that is continuing to change, and it's changing not only from a physical standpoint, but then that is allowing increased human activity of all kinds, which we have not literally seen in really since human civilization. I'm not the first person to use this phrase, but you know, I have said for a long time the Arctic is not a vacuum. You may have heard that as, you know, this is not like Vegas. So what happens in the Arctic does not stay in the Arctic. That's true not only from the physical standpoint. There's a lot of cutting-edge research going on right now to try to determine just how big an effect on the weather that you and I and everybody else live in the Northern Hemisphere is being impacted by the changes in the Arctic. And this is a topic of very hot, pardon the pun, scientific debate. But it's also true from a geopolitical sense. You can look at, as I'm sure everybody in here knows, we've been chairing for about 6 months, the Arctic Council. Admiral Papp is our special representative for that. His job got a lot harder starting about a year ago when President Putin decided to invade Ukraine. Because how does the Arctic get involved in these mid-latitude in like a European or a North American geopolitical issue? It does. It either gets used as then a response, or we need to figure out how to deal with other players in there who have interest in addition to the Arctic. So it's not a vacuum in the science sense. It's also not a vacuum in a geopolitical sense. And I would say it's time to get ready. I think we heard the president talk about this about 5 weeks ago when he was up in Alaska. We have been saying, I've said this when I was in the Navy, I've said this when I was at NOAA, and I say it today, we are the reluctant Arctic power. I would argue that 90% of us don't even know that we're an Arctic nation, but we are. And what we are seeing is an increase, whether we want it or not, an increased opening. We have Arctic coastline, we have Arctic sovereignty. And if we're not ready for that, then we will get into a reaction and a crisis mode. And we know what happens. We end up spending more money, we waste time, and we usually don't get it right several times. Whereas if we do this as a challenge and not a crisis, we usually do a lot better. So this is security, access, and sovereignty, and I'll go through that a little bit later. Okay, just pop quiz. Can we go back one? Pop quiz. What is that picture of? Bering Strait. What are those islands? Diomedes. Who owns the one on the right? Who owns the one on the left? So, on a clear day, if you stand on the west coast of Little Diomede Island, you can see Russia from Alaska. Okay, just wanted to point that out. Next. Okay. All right, this is courtesy of my friends at NOAA. And this is really just a graphical and animated depiction of what I think Jennifer and Julian have already shown you. It's kind of cool. It starts in, I just made this, started in 1994 and 2000, and it goes to about 2012. I'll let it run a couple times here. But what you're seeing, I mean, and for geeks like me, this is really cool because you can see how the ice is actually moving around. It's pushed around by the winds and the currents. It flows out through past Greenland, through the Fram Strait, and you can watch that. But in addition to seeing the amount of ice here, what you're also seeing is how thick it is, because we can measure this with, it's called microwave measurements. So the cool thing is they see through the night, they see through the clouds, you stitch them all together, but you get different returns from really old, hard, thick ice and that young 1 or 2 year ice. So the old, hard, thick ice is in white and the newer ice is in blue. So we'll run it one more time and then we'll stop. But really watch, you know, so here it is, it's in the mid 90s here. You know, and it kind of looks like you can see oscillations and natural variations, maybe a little bit of decrease, but it's kind of hard to tell. So you come up here and wait till 2007. So it's 2004, the scale's on the bottom, 2005, 06, watch what happens in 07. Wham, where'd the ice go? And it tries to come back, sort of like my stock market portfolio tried to come back. And then watch in 2012. The old ice is gone. It's just gone. And right now, there is no indication that that old, hard, thick ice is coming back. So you're going to see years up and down, natural variations. But the trend is clear. And this is really, frankly, the biggest environmental change that we have going on the Earth. Next slide, please. Okay, I could go through a bunch of these, but in the interest of time, we'll just be very, very quick, and I'm just gonna pick a couple of them. It's already been mentioned that the Arctic is still gonna freeze up in the winter. It will for my lifetime, for your lifetime, probably for your children's lifetimes. It's gonna freeze up in the winter. I don't know how many of you have worked in the Arctic. I've done a little bit up there. It's hard. It's still hard. It's still gonna be hard. There is no infrastructure. There's basically no infrastructure up there. So when you're up there, you better bring everything that you need, because if you don't, it's a long ways down to Anchorage or to Dutch Harbor or to wherever you're going there. On the lower left there, I've got the security concerns. And again, in the interest of time, I'll just talk about one thing. So you see that kind of funny looking chart on the bottom of that. That's actually what Russia looks like if you take all the ice out of the Arctic Ocean and you stand at the North Pole. So you look at Russia. Russia is the Arctic nation. They have 50% of the coastline, 21% of their gross domestic product comes from north of the Arctic Circle. For reference, ours is about 0.2%. And they kind of have, you know, almost it's like the Gulf of Mexico on steroids. They have three rivers, each the size and scope of the Mississippi, flowing into the Arctic Ocean. Natural gas, mineral, fishing. They've got all of that, so they're exploiting that. So when we see Arctic development in Russia, you know, we kind of use our Gulf of Mexico like that. So just because they're developing the Arctic isn't like, oh my God, those evil Russians. I would not say that. I would say that's a normal kind of function there. Let's go to the next slide in the interest of time. Okay, you've kind of seen the trade routes. The only thing I would add, I think Julian covered this really nicely, is the Northwest Passage, regardless of the ice, it's kind of like Route 66. You know, we all know about Route 66. It's mythical. It's, you know, it's kind of cool. James Dean, all that sort of thing. But if you're driving a ship, the Northwest Passage is hard. It gets narrow. It's shallow. There are some tricky, what we would call navigation detail components of this. So if you're out on the other side, that red line is that northern sea route that the Russians sort of work to keep open. This comes out of the US Navy's revised Arctic roadmap, by the way. The kind of the wild card in this is, I hope you can see it, it's that green line. And the US Navy is on record as saying, you know, maybe by the mid-2020s that starts to open up for a little bit. That's a guesstimate. You know, it's not a take it to the bank, it's a guesstimate. But that becomes even shorter, international waters, deep water. And I can tell you there are certainly countries in places like Finland, in Asia, that are actually developing merchant vessels that can transit unassisted through first-year ice. And remember, we're getting more and more first-year ice. Now, will they be allowed to do that? Will they have the insurance? Do we have the charting? There's a ton of questions still. It's not like people are going to do it today or tomorrow. But people are thinking about that, and more than thinking about it, they're putting private million-dollar bets on that happening. Next slide. Okay, I'm going to show you. I hope this plays here. Yeah. Watch the blue, watch that red line. It's now about to go through the Northern Sea Route. This is what I call the Nordic Orion Summer Cruise. It's done by a couple private companies, Metron and Exact Earth. We've taken the automated identification system data, and then we took the ice data and put it all together. The kind of cool thing you see now, that ship is going back through the Northwest Passage. Let's see if we can run it again. I know this animation doesn't always quite behave. We'll do it one more time. If we can go back and let's see if it starts. So comes out of the Baltic, goes down through the North Sea Route, and the kind of the cool thing about this is the first known commercial vessel transit of both the Northern Sea Route and the Northwest Passage in 1 year. Happened in 2013. Goes to China, goes to Vancouver. Now watch the ship come back through the Bering Strait, this time through the Northwest Passage, and goes home. So yeah, that's one of, and people say, yeah, that's one of. Couple things. One, it hadn't been seen before. And two, I think it's kind of a nice example of how private sector companies can take publicly available data, fuse it, put it together, and come up with insights. Okay, I'm going to talk just a little bit about security. We've talked a lot about the US piece of the Arctic right now. I'm going to go to the other side. This is a little island off the northeast coast of Greenland called Svalbard. Anybody gone to Svalbard? If you ever have the chance, go. It's really cool. In all ways. But this is a picture on Svalbard. This is not episode 2 of Star Wars. It sort of looked it, though, when you drive up there. It turns out that Svalbard is so far north, it's up to 80 degrees north almost, it can actually see, if you will, and control every single polar orbiting satellite on every single orbit. So that's like just about 100 minutes. Every 100 minutes it gets to see those. You go up there, they have better internet than they have at my house on that island. They've got a trained workforce, they've got a ton of infrastructure, very high speed fiber optics leading to the European mainland. It is a marvelous command and control facility for basically everybody's satellites. And on the left, you can kind of see just some of the companies, European companies, private sector, government, NASA, NOAA, they all use Svalbard as one of the command and control stations. Fairbanks is good. Svalbard sees actually every single satellite, every pass. But the kind of interesting thing about Svalbard is there's this thing called the Treaty of Svalbard. It came out of World War I. And kind of the summary of, it's sort of like Facebook, it's complicated. It's mostly Norwegian, but not totally Norwegian. And then when you get to the waters around it, it gets even fuzzier. Who pushes on things that aren't quite clear? My friends, the Russians. You know, in fact, right after we visited, their deputy prime minister showed up in Svalbard, totally unannounced. And the way the Norwegian government found out about it was by watching CNN or Al Jazeera. So you can imagine how that went. Why does all this matter to us? You know, hey, we're on the other side of the world. Well, Norway is part of NATO. NATO has something called Article 5. Article 5 says an attack on one is an attack on all. If somebody messes about with Svalbard, is that Norwegian or not Norwegian? What about the waters around it? These are things that we as a policy, as a security community, want to think through so that we don't get ourselves dragged into a crisis and really be kind of winging it as we go. So just a really interesting geopolitical, a combination of changing environment, increasing people, and a lot of strategic importance of one place. It all kind of comes together in Svalbard. Next slide, please. Okay, just very briefly, you know, when we talk Arctic, I mean, I've been up to Barrow and the Canadian Dew Line. It's sort of like those top two pictures on the left and an ice camp. That's sort of what we think of as the Arctic. It's, you know, the frontier, and when you find, you know, sort of, you know, people are subsistence living, you know, the walruses are hanging out to cure in front. This picture is actually, again, it's Svalbard in the bottom. It's sort of like where you would bring your significant other for a nice winter vacation or think about holding the Winter Olympics. Lots of infrastructure, very developed, very high north. But when we hear Arctic, we kind of have something in our mind. Just as you work with foreign colleagues and partners, when they say Arctic or High North, they may have a very different mental image than what we do. So just the takeaway from this is there are a lot of different Arctics, and we just need to know which one we're talking about and be cognizant that there are many different Arctics. Next slide, please. Okay, these are my personal recommendations, although I've got them written up in a few places, things that we should be thinking about. We should be thinking about as a nation. We've already heard how important better near-term ice predictions are, and I could not endorse that more heavily. That gets into the weather part. We were mentioned about how the weather prediction in the polar regions lags. When I was chief operating officer at NOAA, I asked the then acting head of the Weather Service, who had been the director of the Alaska region, and I said, so how would you compare them? And the answer I got back is our 5-day forecast for like Washington, D.C. is better than a 2-day forecast for Alaska. We've got a lot of space to make up in there. But it's not just weather. It's not certainly not just icebreakers. We could talk a whole day about icebreakers. I'm not going to do that here. Communications, domain awareness, what's going on up there? We spend literally billions and billions of dollars by the Department of Homeland Security to secure our borders in the lower 48. So does it make much sense if you could just sort of walk along the coast, you know, get to Prudhoe, get to Barrow, you get on Alaska Airlines, and boom, you're here. You know, so from a Homeland Security perspective, I'm not saying people are doing that, but, you know, why do you spend all the money to protect the borders if you can just sort of treat it like the Maginot Line? Fine, I'll go around, you know. So there's all those kinds of things. Next. You know, and here's the way ahead. And again, without getting into the details of this, it's really how do we elevate our commitment and engagement? I think most people would say we do really pretty well on science. We can do more, but we do pretty well on science. But how do we back up that security, that access, that sovereignty that I talked about on the first page? There is something called the Arctic Security Forces Roundtable. That is actually a way in which militaries can talk about security issues. Admiral Zukunft has recently talked about the Arctic Coast Guard Forum. That would be an adjunct to that. We can talk about law of the sea in Q&A if you would like to. And I would just like to bonus on Julian's point about, you know, this idea of prediction. There is a program that has been funded by the Congress, thank you, for several years now called Earth System Prediction Capability. It was actually funded by the HASC and the SASC. It is in the Department of Defense and specifically the Department of Navy's budget. The idea is to have a coupled air, sea, ocean, ice, and land model that goes from 0 hours out to 30 years. And you've got to, you know, sort of at time scales that people care about, if you will. So the Congress is being very, very supportive of that. And in fact, in the, I don't know if Fern is here or not, but in the one of the recent Senate bills on weather forecasting, Earth System Prediction Capability was called out by the Senate. Side there. So this is more than a security issue, and there is in fact a mechanism. So when you look at what Julian and Jennifer talked about, there's already a funded mechanism to do that. Okay, and with that, I'll stop and happy to take any questions in the Q&A point. Thank you.
So thank you to all three of our speakers. Now it's your turn. We have about 25 minutes before we have to vacate the room. So I believe there is a roving microphone somewhere. If you would like to ask a question, if you could just put your hand up, and I hope that somebody will bring a microphone to you. Oh, there isn't a moving microphone. So just. Raise your voice after your hand, and we'll take questions now. And I'll try and spot if questions are coming behind me. Yeah, in the second row here.
I have read, I don't know if I'm correct, that the Arctic has military before, you know, prehistoric time. So what makes it something this time different, and why should we stop it?
So I'll just repeat the question. The question was whether or not we've seen an ice-free Arctic in the past, and what is so different about this time. Actually, Julian and I were talking about this before. There's a paper that came out in Nature about 3 or 4 years ago that looks back at sea ice records, and this is the most ice-free the Arctic has been in about 1,500 years, based on that paper. Of course, going further back in time is challenging. I mean, sea ice is very responsive to climate, but it's also, we didn't have satellites going way far back. And so some of our records come, for example, from Greenland. But Greenland may not be representative for what's going on north of Alaska. So I guess I would say, I can say with a lot of confidence, based on this paper, I think about 1,500 years, but probably much longer. Why this is concerning is because we're at the highest levels of greenhouse gases that we've seen in 800,000 years. So the mechanisms that caused reductions in Arctic sea ice loss in the past, they were related to other things. They weren't related to us. We have a lot of control over Arctic sea ice. It's very responsive. So it's in that way, it's kind of a good thing. If we reduce greenhouse gases in the atmosphere, the sea ice should come back. And I don't know if Julian wants to add on to that.
Yeah, I'll just add on briefly to that. So what is interesting, I mean, if you were to compare what's happening today and we look at it in terms with our climate models, what I think is interesting in regards to the Arctic is every single climate model also simulates a rate of decline that matches. I mean, it's the rate of ice loss doesn't necessarily match what we're seeing in the observations. The observations tend to be melting, showing ice melt happening faster. But they're consistent that it should be going down. And that doesn't happen when you run the models without this increase in greenhouse gases. And what's also interesting about it, I mean, every climate model could be in its own phase of natural climate variability, but they're all showing a decline. So that really does help implicate greenhouse gases. And when we use the models to try to assess, you know, how much of the ice loss that we've been seeing over the last four decades is a result of greenhouse gases versus natural climate variability, it's about 50 to 60% we estimate is probably due to greenhouse gases, and the other 40 to 50% is due to natural climate variability.
Let me just try to also add something to the, so why do we care? Because if this has happened before. And this really gets into, as we change the climate, there's the climate is changing. It's changing more than what we have seen in the course of human civilization. So it's not that the climate has not changed before. In fact, it has. You know, people say, many people say, that the climate is always changing. And when you go to, let's say, 50, 100,000 year timescales, that's absolutely true. It's been warmer, it's been colder. But since we've had human civilization, which is really only a very, very short time, 8,000, 10,000 years coming out of the last ice age, we've had this almost Goldilocks period of basically climate stability relative to what the Earth can do. That is now changing, and we know why. So we are now going to embark on this experiment with 8 billion people and how we are going to feed them and provide them water and some type of energy in an environment that we have literally, in the course of human civilization, never seen before. So this is why it matters. Thanks.
There was a question in the front row.
Yeah, I just wanted to talk a little bit more about atmospheric ice and its importance in following your ice, whether or not that's more helpful than seeing the ice. And so if you use the same center ice with more fluid, smoothly ice, it could have been kind of what happens when you have zero in the ice.
So the animation that David showed was actually of the ice age. So with satellites, we're able to track through a Lagrangian approach, just keeping track of every individual ice parcel as it moves around the Arctic. And if it doesn't melt out in the summer, then it gets aged another year. And so that's one way that we keep track of multi-year ice. And so we've seen a big decline in the amount of multi-year ice in the Arctic Ocean, you know, during the satellite data record. So, for example, after 2012, there were 70% of the Arctic Ocean was covered by first-year ice rather than multi-year ice. And obviously, one of the differences, a big difference, is every year in the wintertime, the first year ice will grow to about 1.5 to 2 meters thick, whereas the longer the ice stays in the Arctic Ocean, the more it grows over successive, you know, seasons. And so it represents a fundamental thinning of the ice. And obviously, if the ice is about 1.5, 2 meters thick, it's easier to melt out in summer than the thicker, older, multi-year ice. And in fact, if we look, so, you know, back in sort of the 1980s, about 30% of the Arctic basin consisted of ice that was at least 5 years or older. Today, it's less than 5%. So you're really losing that oldest, thickest ice in the Arctic. If you want to add on.
Just that's every, you know, what Julienne said. But sort of they, so why do we care? Let's say from a human perspective, I think she gave a great, you know, the physical issues here. The multi-year ice is much, much harder. I mean, now it sounds kind of weird because it's like if you get hit with a block of first-year ice, that feels plenty hard enough. But the multi-year ice, I mean, it's like a rock. It is really, really hard. It's actually fresh water. You can go mine it. If you're out on an ice camp, that's what you look for, to mine to get fresh water. But with multi-year ice, basically human activity is really not, on the surface, is really not possible. You're not going to drive ships through there. You would need multiple heavy icebreakers to get through that. And, you know, and merchant ships, like when I showed that green line as this potential for opening up as soon as maybe 10, 15 years from now, if you had multi-year ice, you just wouldn't even be thinking about that. But with the collapse of the multi-year ice, you get much more softer ice that then becomes engineering and cost feasible to design ships other than the big, big icebreakers to at least be somewhat safe in there. There's also much, much more variability. The ice tends to move around. It breaks up more. I think you may have seen that the Russians actually had to do an emergency evacuation of one of their ice camps. I've been out on these ice camps, and I can tell you it's getting harder and harder to find a piece of ice that you have real confidence is going to be there in 2 months from now, because this single-year ice, it's here today, it's gone tomorrow. So just from a scientific perspective, but also as we open up the Arctic, it's probably as big a deal as the actual decrease in ice. It's the thinning and the lack of multi-year ice that is allowing, again, we can think for better or worse, but it is allowing much increased human activity. Thanks.
Other questions?
Yeah. This is probably for the, I'd be interested in the whole panel's perspective on this, but given your individual analysis and work in this area, have you participated in, or do you see other studies that look at these forecasts within the context of broader global climate or even regional climate, salinity, those kinds of questions and implications, impacts, in terms of these rather dramatic forecasts that are coming out?
Yeah, I'll start. So I'll say some of the forecasts that Julienne showed are made with global climate models. So they're the same models we're using to do a 30-year prediction. We're also trying to use them in a seasonal forecast framework. And the UK has really pioneered this. They call it seamless prediction. So they use the same model to do their weather forecasting that they do to do the climate. And that makes sense because climate is just, you know, traditionally defined as a 30-year average, which is the 30-year average of weather. So I think there's a lot of synergies. And one thing I would recommend from a scientific standpoint is to not to splinter the activities, to focus, because when you start funding 10 different models to do prediction, you have 10 groups that are trying to compete with each other to do the same thing. And I mean, maybe two groups competing with each other, because then you get a little competition, and one person wants to do another better. But 10 is maybe not an optimal number. And I know there's been some high-level reports that have come out from the academies and stuff saying similar things. And yet, I'm very troubled by seeing some of the fragmentation of funding in prediction. I think that's concerning.
Sure. Okay.
David.
Yeah, I'll just also say that, you know, what Jennifer kind of did was sort of lay out my pitch, if you will, for Earth System Prediction Capability, or ESPC. The idea with this, and it before it was proposed as a formal program of record to the Congress in the President's budget about 5 years ago, there was a lot of discussion between NASA, NOAA, the Air Force, Navy, Department of Energy, as to can we come together? And this is not an easy thing for federal agencies to do for a lot of different reasons. User agencies such as Department of Homeland Security, Department of Agriculture, Federal Aviation Administration all said, hey, if you guys had something like that, that would be good. Now, what Jennifer brought out, though, is you may not want to put all your eggs in one basket. So there is a scientific question of how many models do you want? Or can you partner saying, we're going to build the best model in the United States, and then we're also going to then partner with the Europeans. They're going to build their best model, or the Brits are going to build their best, maybe somebody in Asia. And is that your multi-model? Or do we want to do it in the US? Do we want to have two, possibly three, really, really good ones? But we don't probably want everybody who has, you know, an iPhone to go and write their own global model there. So, I mean, it's a great, it's both a science question and also, frankly, it's a policy question. It's a great question for the committees probably represented here to think about, and what is a strategy? You know, to be very honest, we don't have a strategy in this country. We have every federal agency sort of makes the best case, and I've been there, done that. I've been the federal agency guy, and I can make a good case. But we haven't really taken control of this issue. Okay, I'll get off my soapbox now, but that's, it's a great question. Thanks.
Other questions? Yes, James.
So the question, it's a great sort of question, and I'll just paraphrase it for the microphone there so the folks taping can hear, is where we talked about, you know, how we are with different countries. We're probably doing well in science and maybe not quite as well in some other facets. But if you only had, see if I get it right, James, if you had a dollar to spend, $1, where would you put that dollar? And again, I would go back to the fundamentals. I would sort of do an analysis. I don't know, can we go back a slide? Just click back two slides. Boom, boom. I would go back through there and I would do a quick analysis, and I'll bet it's being done because we in general are not lacking for studies about the Arctic and roadmaps and implementation plans. I've written some. But some of these things, observations, domain awareness, the charting, those are pretty, whatever we do in the Arctic, we're going to need that kind of data. So like the ability to do better weather, ocean, ice forecasting is pretty fundamental. The ability to have the charting so that when and if, and it doesn't matter if it's Shell, of course they've pulled out, but somebody else will be up there, the tourism boats, the big tourist boats, you know, 1,500, 3,000 passengers, median age older than me, if you can believe that, you know, is, I love going on those cruise boats because I feel young. The, you know, those guys and gals are going to need good charting, good hydrographic. The communication sometimes gets forgotten about up there, but you're up high. So we mostly use, if you're on satellite in the lower latitudes, you tend to use something called geostationary satellites. They sit over the equator, and as long as you're at a, you know, sort of like at 60, 65 north and below, they're pretty good. Once you get up there, it turns out just the geometry is like you're looking right at the horizon and you can get a lot of interference. So there are technical ways to get around that, different orbits and stuff like that. A guy named John back there has probably forgotten more about this than I know, John Millay. But those are things, but they take a while to do that. So it doesn't do any good, let's say if you're in a security, whether it's Coast Guard, Navy, to say, hey, let's say we commit to putting assets up there. Well, how are you going to talk to them? On Iridium? Really? To do national command and control? Maybe not. So you need to think through all of those types of things, you know, at what bandwidth, how are you going to control things? If you want to go fly, you know, people like unmanned vehicles, drones, right? How are you going to control them up there? Because your normal communications may not be effective up there. So you got to think through all of that sort of thing. But I would say some of the very foundational things, I think things we can all agree on, and I'm not trying to like shy away from the icebreaker thing, but I know the icebreaker has been so, you know, pardon the pun, polarizing. And it's like, hey, where are we going to get the money? And, you know, we could talk about that. But before we go and like ice harden U.S. Navy ships, I would frankly look at these foundational, fundamental things before we go and get ourselves going down there. Does that, hopefully that helps. Okay, thanks, thank you.
Yeah, I think we have time maybe for one or perhaps two more questions, if anyone has any more questions.
Yeah. I would love to. Thank you for that question. So the question was UN Convention on the Law of the Sea and in the Arctic. So UN Convention on the Law of the Sea, I think most people know, actually was written in the 1970s primarily by United States maritime lawyers to lock in advantages that the United States saw that we had back then as a superpower. And as we all know, the Senate so far has chosen not to accede or ratify that treaty. We are the only Arctic nation that has not done that. And in day-to-day operations, it's frankly, it's a little bit embarrassing. I mean, if you go and if you have Admiral Papp come and give you either a briefing, Admiral Zukunft, the Chief of Naval Operations, I had this question like every time when you talk to our European partners, and you talk about the Arctic, the very first question is, you guys aren't even a member of the UN Convention. And our response is, by customary international maritime law, we basically follow the law of the sea. And that's good tactically, you know, on a day-to-day level. But look at, I would look at a few things. So we know, everybody here probably knows that the Russians filed a big claim, and people were saying, oh my God, the Russians are claiming the North Pole. I didn't see the media get so wound up when Denmark also claimed the North Pole, but that's Denmark, right? So that's okay. But that's actually, absolutely, they are following the international convention. There's basically a whole bunch of homework to do, and they went back, they filed first, they were told you didn't do enough homework, they went and did their homework, and they filed again. We can't file that. So although we've done a bunch of the homework, we had one of the better examples of polar cooperation. We had our U.S. Coast Guard cutter Healy with the Canadian Coast Guard cutter Louis Saint Laurent. One would break ice and one would do the survey, and we traded all the data. So we have the data. We would know what our basically what's called extended continental shelf claim would look like. We're basically kind of, that's money on the table that we're leaving. You know, what's on that seabed and under that seabed, we don't know exactly, but we know it could be the United States. We know if we took all of the extended continental shelf that is potentially available to the U.S., I forget how many Californias it is, but it's a bunch of them. It's a lot of undersea land, and we're just simply not claiming it. So there's that ability, there's that issue. The other issue, I think maybe even more important, you know, these treaties and conventions do not stay static forever. At some point, a number of countries will say, you know, this was a great treaty for the 70s and 80s and 1900s, but it's not a 21st century treaty. We're going to renegotiate it. We're not even at that table. We don't even get a vote on that. And, you know, it's not too hard. I mean, I could imagine if I was in another, let's say, large Asian country, I won't mention, but if I started going around to the Pacific Islands, it says, you know, your exclusive economic zone where you can fish, basically it's yours, because the waters are warming and they're changing in chemistry, the fish aren't there anymore, are they? And you will get most Pacific Island nations to say, no, they're not. So this law of the sea thing, it's not doing you any good. Maybe we need to make some of the Arctic waters yours. And they might say, that's an interesting idea. I hadn't thought of that. So you end up with a coalition of countries that might want to possibly change the law of the sea. Maybe they make the South China Sea internal waters. That would not be good for us. We don't get a seat at that table. Now, I know some people will say, yeah, but we've got a really big military, so it doesn't matter. You know, but we've seen there are certainly limits on how you use militaries. You know, that doesn't, you know, it doesn't always work out that well. So being able to have substantive influence on a treaty, and it kind of starts with being a member to that treaty, is, I think, very, very advantageous. So I think the security establishment, industry, every former Secretary of State of both parties has basically said, you know, we need to do this, but there are people here who know far, far better than me why we haven't done that yet, and that's where we are. Thanks.
That one last question from the back.
You showed that sometimes it's good and sometimes it's not so good. So can you talk a little bit about the science that still needs to be done, the resources that you need in order to get to a point where you think it will get better?
So I did try to talk about that a little bit in my slides. So I mean, one of the things we do know we need is we need more observations in the Arctic. So there's definitely certain parts of it that were very data poor. So thickness, for example, is one of those metrics that we don't really have available to us right now. And it's not just the sea ice thickness. I mean, even just better knowledge of sea surface temperatures, knowing we don't even have a whole lot of weather data or information up in the Arctic, so we have very few stations that we can get sort of weather forecasting data for. So obviously being data poor is a big part of it. And then, you know, like I said, we're kind of playing a catch-up game because this is still sort of a new science in a lot of ways to try to do these seasonal ice forecasts up in the Arctic. And so there's a lot of different groups participating now. We've had more than 1,700 contributions to our sea ice outlook since 2008. So we're getting a lot of input. And so, but we don't ever, you know, there's all different sort of methods for doing that. And we need more of a robust assessment, I think, with some of these methods to really understand, you know, what can bring about increased skill in our predictability. We're always going to be limited to some extent by weather, by the chaotic nature of the atmosphere. And that's something we can't really get around, but there are certainly ways we can improve our forecast skill. And it's interesting because when you look at sort of these perfect model experiments where they know everything basically and they try to perturb the either sea ice thickness or sea surface temperatures, there's a lot of memory in the system. So we do know that, you know, you might be able to predict sea ice theoretically maybe 2 years out from some of these modeling studies, but in the real world that's not happening yet. And so we need to better understand why that is.
Okay, I think it's time to finish. So I want to thank again our speakers for sharing with us some of their research results and their insights. I'd like to thank all of you for attending today. Please reach out to our speakers or UCAR staff in the room if we can answer more of your questions. An advertisement, UCAR will be holding its next briefing in mid-February, and that will be on aviation safety. So I hope to see many of you then. Thank you.